Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I myself traveled from the other end of Bombay to this hotel and saw how long it takes. I know many here have undertaken the same travel, and my most sincere gratitude for all of you for taking the trouble to be here. I'm deeply grateful for that. As a beginning of the arguments and issues I want to raise, let me start with a question. An honest, sincere question. I would like each one of you to actually engage with the question in terms of yourselves. The question is the following. Can you think of any instance in the last 3 years when you saw an opportunity of doing something that would be of significant value to your company, but for whatever reason, you did not pursue it? I mean, you either did not get started, you gave up because of difficulties, you didn't have the resources, the climate wasn't right. Whatever the reason is, forget the reason, how reasonable the reason is, how compelling the reason is, whatever they may be, can you think of one instance in the last 3 years when you saw a great opportunity, something you could do, and looking back, you say, well, didn't do it. Didn't got going, didn't do it. How many of you can think of at least one such incident in the last 3 years? Raise your hands. Lots of hands. The number of hands that went up in response to that question is the justification for this topic. Increasingly, I find perhaps the most significant strategic problem for a company, lies in this issue of action taking. Yes, occasionally a great strategic idea is great, and many companies, some companies sometimes make this big jump based on this one brilliant new strategic idea of creating a new business model. That happens. Yes, all the flexibility, turning on a dime, that's important. Some companies sometimes get advantage out of that. That is true. But the most important thing that allows companies, to my limited experience, in terms of making that progress, getting to that level of excellence, is purposeful action taking. We talk a lot about knowledge, and knowledge is very important, and knowledge management is very important. In my limited experience, I increasingly find that a vast majority of managers, knowledge really isn't the problem. Deep in their guts, they know roughly, not precisely, but roughly, what they ought to be doing. The real problem is knowing what they ought to be doing. A vast majority of managers simply do not do those things. A little background of the study itself. As I said, the issue came to me in the course of working with these companies. Then 3 years ago, I started the sort of research process itself. The first study was a study in Lufthansa. The background of Lufthansa, 1991, Lufthansa was this close to bankruptcy. Jürgen Weber, the CEO of Lufthansa, personally went from bank to borrow money to pay next month's wages, not from buying aircrafts, not for acquiring companies, not for strategic investments, to pay next month's wages. All the major banks in Germany turned that down, including Deutsche and Dresdner. The CEOs of both those banks sit on Lufthansa board. None of them believed Lufthansa has a chance of survival. The reason the company survived was the Canton Bank came up with some bridging finance and so on. From that position in 1991, by 1995, it's a marvelous, magnificent story of corporate transformation, corporate renewal. Lufthansa is back on its feet. At that point, Weber, in his personal initiative, started a special project. He said, let's find the highest potential young executives throughout Lufthansa, bring them to Lufthansa School of Business, and give them the following challenge. Say, you know Lufthansa, you are the highest potential people we have, you are the youngsters, you are the future of the company. All right. You decide, use the resources, resources included academics, resources included senior management time, you decide one project that you think will be of great value to Lufthansa, define it, and then execute it. 78 projects got started. We followed The project leaders of these projects, in total 130, over a two-year period, what happened to these projects? Realize everything is controlled. These are all high-potential people, competent people. They have all defined their own projects. They have full resources, money, time, whatever they need. Now, as you can expect, there was a wide variance in outcomes, all the way from some projects that produced results that nobody in senior management could believe was possible. I'll give you an example. For airlines, statutory charges is either the second or the third largest item of cost. Wages, fuel, statutory charges. All airlines operate with this firm belief, statutory charges are not controllable. What can Lufthansa do about how much they have to pay for landing slots in Heathrow? It's not controllable. One team, one leader with a team said, yep, uncontrollable, but it's our third highest item of cost. We will reduce statutory charges by 10%. Nobody believed it's possible. Everybody in senior management, but the rule was, you know, you define the problem, you go ahead. Nobody can stop it, fine. That team did an amazing job. I mean, on the one end, technical work in terms of route planning and so on the other end, negotiations, slight adjustments in different airports, and produced, you know, almost 200 million Deutsche Mark savings. All the way from that kind of success to a large number of projects which didn't even get off the ground. The project team didn't even have a first meeting. Nothing happened. Wide variance. That was the first study. Why is it so? Why do some people take those actions, make those things happen, others don't? Then we replicated the same study in Conoco, this time looking at 250 managers in Conoco who are project managers with concrete projects, looking at their outcome. Then we looked at company level, some broad changes in companies. For example, Oracle moving from being a database company to internet-based integrated provider of total solution. That whole transformation, specific projects like Sony introducing the biocomputer, focusing on action in a variety of contexts. That's what the database behind what I'm going to talk about, that's where it comes from. The way I thought I'll structure the discussion today is the lessons that, and this is the work done jointly with Heike Broek. Heike did her habilitation, which is the sort of second PhD in Germany with me in London, and is now a professor of strategic leadership at St. Gallen University. First lesson, only 10% managers take purposeful action. In the Lufthansa study that I talked about, as we said, we really followed over a two-year period, only 10% managers take purposeful action. And then as we analyzed why they take, why they don't take, who doesn't take, these two variables fell out very clearly. One is energy and the other is focus. All organizations are designed to prevent action. That's what organizations are. They are designed to prevent change. Therefore, any kind of significant action, significant change, significant improvement needs a huge amount of personal energy. The first study, Lufthansa, the results were very, very similar as we replicated the study in Conoco with a much larger number, 250 managers. About 30% of these managers were procrastinators, low energy, low focus. They neither had the energy to really move through their actions, nor did they have the ability to stay focused on those specific goals. About 20% managers were what we called disengaged managers. They were not butterflies. They were not going all over the place. They were, you know, specific and, yeah, disciplined people, high focus, but they simply didn't have the energy to break through, to make things happen. The worst, simply because it's the highest proportion, 40%, were what we call distracted managers. High energy, low focus. I suspect all of you know these managers. Some of you may have been there, some of you may be there today. Lots of energy, you know, lots of ideas, And these managers, whenever a proposal comes up, they volunteer, yes, I'm going to do this. They start many things. They don't finish any. And only 10% are purposeful action takers, managers who have that energy to drive and yet the focus to concentrate that energy on one or a few things that they are trying to achieve. What does it take for a manager to be focused on a few goals and persist with them over time? A vivid mental picture. If you want to achieve something, if you want to do something, to create a picture in your mind of the end state, of what happens when it is achieved. And in most of these cases, the people who are able to remain focused over time created a clear mental picture of what they want to accomplish. They visualize the process, including obstacles. Second is this issue of a personal commitment. At the heart of that lies this thing about bringing cognition, reason, together with emotion. Organizations are playground of human emotions, and they matter. Typically in management, you totally focus on the reason, ignoring the emotions. That is a barrier to having that focus moving forward. Now what people do is, they create based on reason the goal, and then they try to self-discipline their emotions in two ways. Either they try to, through self-discipline, bring positive emotions to that reason-based goal, or they try to suppress the negative emotions against that goal. Both of them are valid, and most managers, most effective managers, become skillful at both those processes. But ultimately, self-discipline only carries you this far. In contrast, in each of the cases where we saw some remarkable achievements, the guy who built the carbon fiber business in Conoco, the guy, Wim Alberter, who started the entrepreneur, started this business of these micro scooters that have now become a phenomenon worldwide, they found a combination where their personal emotions, their personal desires overlap with reason, with cognition in that area. And the second is, confront doubts, anxieties, conflicts. Most managers facing, okay, this is what I'm going to do. Deep down, there are doubts, anxieties. What do I stop doing? Do I really want to do it? But again, we have created a management process where we absolutely ignore those. As a part of delegitimization of emotion, we don't confront them. And then they come back to haunt you through the execution process. On the other hand, those who are able to retain focus right up front at the time of accepting that goal, accepting that project, actually play through their doubts, their anxieties, deal with them so as to develop the resoluteness that then plays out as focus over the goal. With regard to energy, again, a set of factors. First, these words, I hope, will improve over time and stop becoming so abstract and become more practical. Right now, I say cognitive attachment. What do I mean by that? Clear and ambitious goals to maintain energy over time against a goal. First, the goal must be clear. Most managers start with vague, ambitious goals. Vague, ambitious goals do not provide the basis of sustaining energy over time. And second, the goal has to be ambitious. Routine goals, ordinary goals, never create that extra energy for going that extra mile. Clear, ambitious goals. Second, a sense of self-confidence. For younger managers, mentoring often provides a surrogate for self-confidence. That is why I think mentoring by senior, experienced people can play such an important role. And the second is the emotional side. First is, not having negative feelings about the organization, the team, and so on. If people are pissed off with the work, with the company, with the team, they are not going to develop the energy no matter what, no matter how many motivational speeches you give, no matter what commitments they make in front of you. But the absence of negative feeling is different from the presence of positive feeling. It's a combination of those two. The one key requirement, at one level, is so obvious, and yet, in practice, it is So rare to understand it, because if you understand it, you can do something about it. In a joyful environment where you feel happy about work, that is almost a precondition for building energy. Business is the central hazard of purposeful action taking. We have created in companies an enormous. No manager is idling. If you really go and look at your company, all managers are busy. And this business, the 40% distracted managers, that's the most expensive category. Why most expensive? These are typically people who actually have high energy, high commitment in your companies. They can be enormous productive resource. That resource being wasted in business is a major resource loss for the company. Most procrastinators today were distracted, busy yesterday. These busy managers cost a lot to the company. They are typically very short-sighted. They initiate a lot of things without thinking through the implications. They underestimate time requirements, underestimate resource requirements. In the process, they actually, like a bull in the china shop, they have a huge negative effect on the company. Very often, managers who do not achieve purposeful action taking, really get stuff done, suffer from a feeling of overwhelming demands, too many demands, constraints, unsurmountable constraints, too many constraints in my being able to do it, resource constraints, colleague constraints, technology constraints, mark constraints, and choices, unexplored choices. Those are the three primary bases of active non-action. Overcoming the trap of overwhelming demands. Managers who overcome this, the demands are the same. In Lufthansa, all these managers, the demands around them were the same, yet some took action, some didn't. How did these people manage? The same thing where somebody said, I can't do anything, there's too many things going on. How did somebody else manage? First, an explicit personal agenda. Purposeful action takers have an explicit personal agenda. The others don't. If you don't have an explicit personal agenda, all you can do is react. Slow down, prioritize, reduce, organize demand. Practice in this world where the entire rhetoric is speed. Practice slow management. Structure contact time. And again, I think for younger managers, this is a particularly serious problem. You have become a senior guy, and you say, look, I'm a good person, right? I'm modern, open door, anybody can come in. Isn't that the tenet of modern management? No, it isn't. Structure contact time. Structure contact time with those who report for you. Manage expectations. Purposeful action takers, because of the personal agenda, constantly manage the expectations of others so as to create space for their own action-taking and consciously build social networks. It may sound sort of very instrumental, but that's what they do. Overcoming the trap of unsurmountable constraints. Oh, you know, it's too much. How many managers have I heard? You know, I would love to do it, but you know, too many constraints. Map relevant constraints. As long as you think of a vague notion of too many constraints, it will always be too many constraints. But if you map, given this intention, given this intent, given this purpose, what are the real constraints? First thing you find is most of the constraints are not really constraints for doing this. From that vagueness of too constrained, map the relevant constraints. Be willing to accept trade-offs. Very often, if you really want something, then the reason you don't get there and lose energy and focus is you become dogmatic. You are unable to manage trade-offs. For most things, they are the must-haves. And there are the good to haves, nice to haves. Selectively break rules. Now again, this is a delicate one. It's not break rules, break all rules. In our experience in companies, those in big companies, the company that we studied, whether it is Ken Kutaragi, who, you know, this break all rules to build PlayStation, we actually studied what Ken Kutaragi did. It's not break all rules. It is selectively break rules. You have to be an insider to get these things done, to draw the resources. Yet, if you follow all the rules, you don't get there. Understand, selectively break rules. It's not guerrilla warfare. And learn to tolerate conflicts and ambiguity. Very often, managers in this group did not achieve their intent simply because they're not willing to get into conflict. You know, oh, come on, she's a nice person. Why get into trouble with her? Forget it, all right. Have the courage to get into those conflicts as well as the ambiguity in companies. Nothing is decided overnight. Okay, yes, no. It takes time to create the context, to get the decisions, to get the resources. And over that period, You never really know is going to happen or not, and you have to live with that ambiguity for that period if you want to drive forward to your goal. Learn to tolerate conflict and ambiguity. The last, overcoming the trap of unexplored choices. Most managers who say, yeah, but what can I do? There are too many constraints, too many demands, basically confuse a lot of choices for demands. They actually have choices, but they don't see the choices. They see them as constraints or demands. They don't see the space for choices. Become aware of choices. With that, expanding the space for action, build personal knowledge and skills. Perhaps the greatest source of legitimacy for action taking comes from a perception of competence, of knowledge and skills. And there's the last one. It almost sounds like, a triviality. But those who don't enjoy freedom to take action will not make things happen in your company. All right, back to my lessons. The fourth one, perhaps for us the most intriguing lesson. Willpower, not motivation, drives purposeful action. If you take psychology abstracts, will and volition were amongst the highest used words in the abstract up to 1930s. 1949, volition was deleted from abstracting. 1954, the word will was deleted from abstracting. And in that process, we have lost sight of a simple fact. There is this distinction. There are these two worlds. On one side is motivation. It's an outside-in world. Outside lies, the company policies, bosses' preferences, team's choices, all of those things. That outside world defines what I can do, what I should do. That's the world of wish. That's the world of motivation. And then you as leaders create incentives to motivate people. You went do all of that to motivate. And then here is the world of volition. It's an inside-out world. Inside is the will that says, I will do this. And then you change the world outside to allow you to do what you want to do, to make what you do happen. That's the world of will. And in between is this personal Rubicon. And the very few people who actually make the big things happen in companies are typically those who are operating on the right-hand side. The foremost task of leaders is to engage their own willpower. Those of you where your personal willpower is not engaged in the task that you have at hand will definitionally not be able to make that difference. That's the first task of leadership. Also, willpower is not a personality trait. It is not that Dhirubhai Ambani had will and you or I don't. There's an element of that, of course, disposition. But willpower is not a personality trait. It is something that can be managed. It is something, it's an enormous power that you can actually access to different degrees for different individuals, but you can actually access. And leadership can help people access their willpower. The real problem for companies is superficiality. Conversations are superficial, commitments are superficial, and it is that pervasive superficiality that comes in the way of purposeful action taking in companies. And leaders, by adopting the motivational method and doing them well, by the way, actually encourage creating that context of superficiality. What can you do? Help people visualize their intention. As I said, willful managers focus, they create a picture. Flip side, you can help them create a picture. I'll give you a story. This guy in Conoco, Paul Kennedy, Conoco has this new venture. It's a carbon fiber. It's a fantastic new material. Light as steel, totally non-corrosive and so on. He's the head of that business. His job is to build that business. Simply because the product is so absolutely can be used anywhere. That's the exciting thing. He was very excited. But he couldn't start. Where do I start? In the review meeting with the senior team, he said, help me. Where should I start? As opposed to telling him, start here, start there. He said, okay, give us a picture. Give us, what does it look like? This, everything business. Everything possible business. What does it look like? At some point, Paul told me, I suddenly thought, I want a bridge. I want a bridge that will be as strong as steel, that will never rust. I want a bridge. That picture then just unfroze him to begin to build that business. And that's beginning to become a highly successful business of Conoco. Help people visualize their intention. Prepare people for obstacles and difficulties. Again, I'll give you an example. early 90s, when IBM was in trouble, they have a sounding board. And all people proposing projects, the sounding board decides, allocates resources, and so on. What they find is lots of projects come up, very optimistic, and approved projects, only about 15% actually deliver the results they promised. Then Sven Eriksson, who takes that role, completely changes the rule. He said, yeah, up to now, for all projects, you have to say business pluses and minuses, risks, opportunities. But now you have to tell me two other things. Your personal costs and benefits. What did it cost you? And you have to answer questions like, if I didn't do this, given all these difficulties, given all these problems for me, time, whatever, why do you still want to do it? If you did this project, what else would you not be able to do? If you didn't do this project, what else would you do? You have to confront your personal obstacles, ambivalence, doubts, and make that a part of the process. And then, even the last step of the sounding board, last time, the person is asked again, are you sure you want to do it? Most companies do not have a climate of choice. In a top-down organization, willpower cannot survive. People, the only way you can engage your willpower is when it is linked to free choice. There is no free will without free choice. And build a self-regulating system. What do I mean by that? The problem of willpower is the bull. I mean, they can't disengage. They go on with it. Sometimes, when it is manifest, it is the wrong thing to pursue. Stop, cut your losses. They can't. Sometimes when the goal has been achieved, they have so much fallen in love, they continue. At the same time, if arbitrarily you pull the plug, you have destroyed willpower. Build a self-regulating system. But now I come as a last step to the last point, which is also the topic of the whole presentation. Beyond individual level action taking, yours and others, there is an issue of collective action. At times of radical change, you need the whole organization to move in a certain direction. What does it take to build that collective volition, that collective will, everybody in the company moving in a certain direction? And that's this issue of organizational energy. Companies that are able to make truly these path-breaking moves, at their heart lies this issue of managing organizational energy. There are, again, two dimensions. One is the intensity of organizational energy. Some companies have a high level of energy. Others have a low level of energy. And the other is the nature of organizational energy, destructive, constructive. But let me explain that by illustration. Constructive low energy, what I call the comfort zone. Excellent example for me, Old Mutual in South Africa. You know, people respect it, people working inside are middle class, their salaries went great, they all live very middle class lifestyle, respected comfort zone. Till, all of this is still their demutualization. It's not like that today, I'm saying in the past. They have now shifted their headquarters to the UK. They have demutualized, become public, and Old Mutual today looks completely different. But historically, that's the comfort zone. That's comfortable, it's nice. Low energy, but destructive. I call it the resignation zone. My example for that, again, historically, was SKF. Again, it has changed with Sune Carlson coming in. But historically, if you look at SKF, here's a company that created the bearing industry, created the business. For the last, since 100 years, no, no, 97 years, been the global leader in the business, worldwide global leader. But if you take the last 25 years, here's what has happened. Every year, its market share has gradually inched down. It's like a chronic disease. Just like individuals get used to chronic disease, SKF managers have got used to this chronic disease of slight underperformance. That's what I call the resignation zone. Then you can see the corrosion zone. High energy negative. Everything is going into internal fighting. I mean, for me, the best example was Westinghouse. For every division, particularly in the period of Paul Lego as CEO, the CEO had isolated himself in a small coterie, not connected to the business. At the same time, very tight pressures. Every divisional president, the worst enemy was not GE, was not Siemens, was the other divisional president. It was just internal politics, continuous conflict, corrosion zone. And then you have the productive zone, high positive energy. Of the companies that I know right now, I think, I see Sony as a good example. There's digital dream kids. As Sony is trying to move from analog technology-based standalone products, audio, video, camcorder, whatever, to digitized, integrated, internet-based content delivery, Sony Music, Sony Movies. Everything interconnected on the mobile, on the TV, on the bio laptop, on the PDA. This whole transition is an amazing change. How do you energize? How do you build the collective action, the power of the whole company to move? I find basically two ways that companies follow. One is what I call killing the dragon. Typically for companies in the comfort zone, killing the dragon says, leader's job, create a clear dragon, a clear danger, a clear threat, imminent bankruptcy, a terrible competitor, a technological innovation that can obsolete, whatever. Create the dragon, paint the picture, and allow the whole organization to align itself against the dragon. Example, perhaps historically the best example was Komatsu. Komatsu, Japan is protected market, happily inside Japan, earth-moving equipment. Caterpillar is 16 times its size, global leader. Can't come into Japan, market protected. Market opens up. US wants Japan to give access for cars. Japan says, no, cars, we have a chance, we'll hold it. We'll give you, we'll feed the lion by opening up the earth-moving equipment. We don't have a chance in that. For any good management, time to pick up your marbles and go home. Komatsu management insists, says Maru-sei. Not only will you not go home, we'll take on Maru, surround, see, Caterpillar. We'll surround Caterpillar. In symbol of that, they take Caterpillar's biggest bulldozer, put it on top of the corporate head office building, so that every employee entering the office can see this ugly, huge, yellow beast sitting on top of the head office to create energy, killing the dragon. The other is the winning the princess. The killing the dragon doesn't work from the resignation zone. If you're already resigned, chronic disease, and you say, you know, they go even more resigned. It's winning the princess. Paint the picture of the princess. This wonderful, attractive, seductive future. And allow the positive emotion of enthusiasm, energy, excitement behind the princess as another way to get the whole organization aligned. What does it take to allow the people in your company to truly pursue the business goals, not because you are telling them, not because the bonus is right? Ultimately, where purposive action comes from is because they want to do it. Where does it come from? And I think there I will end with this quote from Antoine de Saint-Exupéry. If you want to build a ship, don't drum up the men to go to the forest to gather wood, saw it, and nail the planks together. Instead, teach them the desire for the sea. And wherever I have seen collective, purposeful action taking, I have seen in their abilities, in the leaders, this ability to somehow, in some way, create in their people the desire for the sea. Comments, questions, pushbacks, personal experiences.
In your last slide about unleashing organizational energy, you spoke about two routes, killing the dragon and drawing the vision of the princess. Yeah. But you didn't explain the corrosive to the productive zone. You didn't talk about that part, the third route.
Again, typically what happens is, if you take the underlying emotions that you are playing through, the real emotions in the comfort zone are weak positive emotions like contentment, like calm. Those are the emotions. If you take the resignation zone, they are weak negative emotions like disappointment, like frustration. These are moods. They don't drive to action. Corrosive zone are strong negative emotions like anger, shame, guilt, fear. And the purposive zone, the underlying emotions are excitement, enthusiasm. When you are trying to manage killing the dragon, in the first instance, you are creating strong negative emotions. It is about anger, it is about fear, it is about guilt. For senior management, very often it's about what they haven't done that got the company into the stage. The challenge is, having created them, how do you align? And that, I think, has two key tasks to it. One is to help people see that through collective action, the dragon can be killed. Because if they don't see it, it will all remain in that negative zone. And people have faced that. It becomes internally directed. Help people see. And second is, channel that action and create specific projects with specific project management processes. So people get afraid, get angry, But then they can see that a possibility that through collective action, we can actually kill the dragon. And then they have the forums through specific projects, specific initiatives, that I can actually concretely do something to operationalize that cooperative work into killing the dragon. Those two pieces are what channels that corrosive energy into this positive space.
You talked about passion. Passion to me has to mean a certain amount of unreasonableness. How unreasonable can unreasonable be?
This is a very particular hot button of mine. I'll tell you why. It's about 3 years ago, I wrote an article in the Financial Times, which title was, "Is Asshole Management Inevitable?" I'll tell you what I mean by that. I think worldwide, we are all conspiring into it. I, as business school academic, people here who are from the media, the journalists, managers themselves, all of us are conspiring into creating a picture of management. And the picture we're collectively creating is this, you know, hard-driving, bold, unreasonable, male, sort of an asshole. And that poses really a question. If leadership job is change, what does it take to change ossified cultures? What does it take to change, you know, ossified organizations? It does take unreasonableness. In that case, is the only role for reasonable men and women to step aside, and is the only solution that the corporation, which is perhaps the most important institution of modern society, will only be run by assholes? Noel Tishy wrote the, and where the word came from, where the article was framed was, perhaps the first book that was written about Jack Welch, well before all the Jack Welch books, was Noel Tishy's book on Jack Welch. Noel Tishy is a very world-famous consultant, academic, Welch fan. And Noel described in that book the story, which is actually in Crotonville, GE's training center, a group of young managers debating. And the debate on the flip chart is, Jack Welch is the greatest CEO GE has ever had, one flip chart. Other flip chart says, Jack Welch is an asshole. And they were debating that, and Noel was not saying that Jack Welch is an asshole. What he was saying was, the courage to take these decisions to revitalize a company, as well as the culture where these can be openly discussed. But I mean, there is a real issue. We are collectively in the process of creating this context which is shaping where only unreasonable, between unreasonable and asshole, there is a borderline, but those kind of people can get to top management. And I think that is the case. That would be, in the long term, one of the worst things that could happen to companies and managements, because that is what is underlying the delegitimization that we are seeing of management worldwide. It is not just Enron or WorldCom or Tyco. Worldwide, there is a delegitimization, and its heart is this collective thing we are all building, all of us together, to celebrate a certain kind of macho management. Yet the reality is, if I look, I think Idei, and some of you would know Idei, the most decent, soft-spoken, not really charismatic in any charisma sense. He has a clarity of vision. Here is the digital world that is coming up. Sony, if it has to remain excellent over the next 50 years, as it did over the last 50, has to be a key player in this digital world, not an analog world. And the way to become the customers are digital dream kids. They dream in digital. To meet their requirements, we have to become digital dream kids. And take an absolute clarity, and then pushing it. Biocomputer, his project, when he announces it, not a single person signs up, because Sony has a free sign-up system for projects. Not saying, no, you shall, because I am the CEO telling it. Creating the bio world as a way to allow people inside the company to see this vision, and thereby getting seduced. I think, you know, right now in Europe, for some time, John Brown in BP has been one of the most celebrated CEOs. Last 4 years in running, the most admired CEO and so on. Again, if you look at Brown, it is different. It is very reasoned, very intellectual leadership. I do not see, if unreasonable says the clarity, I have this vision, if you tell me you can't do it, I'm going to keep on questioning, I'm going to keep on trying to seduce, I'm not going to let go. Yes, unreasonable. But the version that very quickly translates in terms of unreasonableness is the asshole. And I think there is a real danger that we'll fall into here in India, because that model is spread very fast, that macho image. For this board wants those in their CEO. CEOs then want those in their next level of managers. The next level of managers dehumanize themselves to get their chance. We are creating the system. And I really think we need to recognize, yes, unreasonable in the sense of the vision, the clarity, and evoking the desire for the sea, but not unreasonable in the sense of overcoming the limit of moral behavior and reason, as the word reason really means, which is acknowledging the power of reason in social conduct. I don't know if I communicated it well, but I personally think that is an important issue. We are facing that issue. 1990s created that. Dan Kozlowski was a product of our collective way of thinking and celebrating management, not just an individual, what we saw in all these American and some European companies. I'm sure some Indian companies too. And I think collectively we have a responsibility to recognize that is not inevitable. And empirically, if I say, I mean, I talk about Jürgen Weber. He's one of the most pleasant, joyful men I've seen. Yes, he's unreasonable in the sense the cost, 15% cost reduction. He drives it throughout the company, constantly repeats it, has town hall meetings throughout the world explaining to people why that is essential. But it's not unreasonable in terms of this macho, top-down unreasonableness that we often confuse it with.
I have one last personal question. How do you sustain that energy level?
I love what I do.
All through the show, you've been extremely energetic.
Thank you. Well, once again, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. Thanks a lot.